Okay, thank you. Dr. Michelle Knight is our next presenter. She is an assistant professor here in the practice department and ambulatory care specialist. And she is going to be talking about her Wyker status.
Thank you. So just a little bit of background about myself. I went to school at Wilkes University, which is in Pennsylvania, and I completed 2 years of residency. The first one was at Florida Hospital Celebration Health, which is right next to Disney in Florida. It was focused in primary care, and then I did a PGY2 residency in ambulatory care in academia at the University of Florida at UF Health Family Medicine. And then I started this position here in July, so I've been here almost a year now, and I still love it. But today we're going to talk about provider status. So the title of this presentation is Are We There Yet? The Road to Provider Status. I have nothing to disclose. So as preceptors, I think it's really important for us to be aware of any issues that might affect our profession and that we're able to answer any questions our students might have for us regarding these. So by the end of this presentation, I'd like you to be able to define provider status for pharmacists, to discuss a report called the 2011 Surgeon General Report and its significance, outline and expand upon the four main focus points of the report, summarize updates and current efforts to achieve provider status, discuss some of the barriers to achieving provider status, compile resources for anyone that's interested in becoming involved, including yourselves and or students. And because this is a preceptor development symposium, I really wanted to give you some ideas to create activities for students that promote advocacy for the progression of clinical pharmacy. And to go along with the theme of the road to provider status, and because I know that we all just ate a lot of food and we might be tired, I have some pit stops along the way in this presentation just to keep you involved and keep you thinking. So let's start off with what is provider status. So because I'm going to focus on the road to provider status, I want to tell you exactly what it is. So we all know that healthcare delivery is challenged by increased demands of cost, quality, and access. And pharmacists that provide expanded patient care services, a lot of what Jennifer talked about in the last presentation, do represent a potential solution to this problem. But we're at a point that we can't continue to expand these services if we don't receive standardized and proper compensation for them. So Medicare and Medicaid determine eligibility for healthcare programs through key sections of what we call the Social Security Act, or the SSA. And most of the state and the private insurers will follow whatever Medicare and Medicaid do, and that's CMS. However, pharmacists are not currently recognized as healthcare providers within the Social Security Act. And ultimately, being recognized in this act would allow pharmacists to bill Medicare Part B for services that are within our state scope of practice. So before we get started, I did want to explain to you how I first became interested in pharmacists trying to achieve provider status. So during my final year of pharmacy school, I completed a rotation at the FDA in Washington, D.C. And towards the end of this rotation, I had the privilege of spending the day with a very influential man, and his name is Admiral Scott Guyverson, and he's pictured here as well. So in addition to being a practicing pharmacist and having many other titles in the government and the United States Public Health Service, he's also the Assistant Surgeon General of the United States. And he's also the primary author of the report, the 2011 Surgeon General Report, which is going to be a lot of the focus of this presentation. Now, the only thing I was required to do before I spent the day with Admiral Guyverson was to actually read his report. So the report is entitled Improving Patient and Health System Outcomes Through Advanced Pharmacy Practice. It's not a light read by any means. It was about 90 pages. It was pretty intimidating to read as a student, knowing that I was going to meet the person that wrote it. But reading this really changed my outlook on pharmacy for the better. And I have a very strong passion for advocating for pharmacists, not just provider status, but advocacy in all areas of our practice. So the easiest way to put it is that after leaving his office, I felt like I needed to go change the world. So I'm very happy to say that I'm still just as passionate about pharmacists achieving recognition as healthcare providers and pharmacists' advocacy on other issues. So as some of you may know, and I know we have a lot of faculty in here, but Admiral Guyverson was the keynote speaker for our voting ceremony this past month. So I was very excited to get the chance to speak with him again, to reconnect, and really share with him the role that he's played in my career in pharmacy thus far. And I got some updated pictures for my presentations. I know that if and when we get provider status, I'll have to pick something different to present on, but for now I've got some updated pictures. So Admiral Guyverson was technically a preceptor to me when I was a fourth year Abbey student, and that was several years ago, and he's still continuing to inspire me in my career today. So this is really encouraging for me as a new preceptor to think about the role that I could have with students that I see at my practice site. And I hope that this inspires all of you as well. So I'm going to highlight some of the main points of this report and demonstrate how it's helped pharmacists fight, or pharmacists in the fight to achieve provider status. But before talking about the significance of this report, I think it's really important to understand the people behind it. So in its simplest term, the Surgeon General report is a really long letter written to the Surgeon General by the Assistant Surgeon General of the United States. So as I mentioned before, Admiral Scott Guyverson was the Assistant Surgeon General, and the Surgeon General at the time was Regina Benjamin, who's pictured up here. Now the overall purpose of this really long letter that was written to the Surgeon General was to provide rationale and compelling discussion to support healthcare reform through pharmacists providing expanded patient care services. So this is our first pit stop on the road to provider status, just to make sure everybody is still awake. So Regina Benjamin was the Surgeon General at the time that that report was written by Admiral Guyverson. So does anybody know who the current Surgeon General of the United States is? I see Crystal thinking.
He's internal medicine or family medicine, I know that.
Does anybody know his name? He's pictured here. Well, hopefully you'll remember his name after the presentation, but this is Vice Admiral Vivek Murthy. He was confirmed by President Obama on December 15th of 2014. Now, the Surgeon General is really an influential person in our country. They're America's doctor. They're responsible for communicating any information to the public regarding ways to improve personal health, but also the health of the nation. And they also oversee the operation of the United States Public Health Service Commission Corps. So as you can imagine, they're in a very influential position, and the support of America's doctor is a very important part of achieving provider status. So I mentioned before that healthcare delivery is challenged by increased demands of cost, quality, and access. And you'll hear those words over and over again because those are the biggest problems that we face today. Now these challenges are further amplified by increases in chronic care, a provider workforce shortage, and also an increase in the access to care. And I'm going to go into each one of these things in detail. But ultimately, we need new or additional paradigms of care to be implemented to reduce some of these burdens. So Jennifer went into a lot of these in her presentation, and I think Dave even had some of this in his presentation. But those increased demands of cost, quality, and access are further amplified by dramatic increases in the number of primary and chronic care visits. So these statistics come from between 2007 and 2009, and I think Jennifer presented some statistics from 2012 that were fairly similar. So 45% of Americans have at least one chronic condition, and 27% have multiple chronic conditions. And chronic care accounts for 81% of hospital admissions, 91% of prescriptions billed, 76% of physician visits, $2.6 trillion in healthcare expenditures, and 99% of Medicare spending. So these are some pretty startling statistics, and I would hope that some of these numbers have improved, but we know for places like West Virginia, these numbers have probably only gotten worse. So those increased demands of cost, quality, and access are also impacted by a provider workforce shortage. So in its simplest terms, the demand for physicians, specifically in primary care, is continuing to grow faster than the supply of physicians that we have. So this graph on the right is provided by the Association of American Medical College, so I just want to take a moment to orient you to the graph. So the years 2013 to 2025 are on the x-axis, and the projected number of physicians is on the y-axis, and I know some of these specific numbers are probably hard to read. The dotted lines that are closer to the bottom of the graph are demand, and the solid colored lines towards the top are supply. Now you'll notice that there's several different colors of lines, so these are based on different factors that might influence the supply and demand of physicians. I'll talk more about some of these, but it might be the Affordable Care Act, expanding insurance coverage, using integrated care delivery models, expanding use of retail clinics, use of nurse practitioners or PAs. So those different colors represent different projection scenarios and where they got those numbers from. Now from the graph, regardless of which color of line you're looking at or which scenario, you can see that both the dotted and the solid lines, or the supply and the demand, are increasing. So in other words, both supply and demand for physicians are expected to increase, but you can see that the lines on the top, which are demand, are rising more steeply. So our demand is going to rise more than our supply, even though they're both going up. So based on this information from this graph, the projected shortfall in primary care is going to range anywhere between 12,500 and 31,100 physicians by the year 2025. So that's a big deficit that we're facing in the coming years. So last but not least, the increased demands of cost, quality, and access are also impacted by an increase in the number of patients that are seeking access to care, and most of this is due to the Affordable Care Act. So it's been estimated that an additional 26 million individuals have medical insurance now under the Affordable Care Act, and the graph on the right shows the projected change in Medicare enrollment from the years 2000 to 2050. So Medicare enrollment is represented by the light blue line along the y-axis, and then the average growth in enrollment is shown by the dark blue bars at the bottom of the graph on the x-axis. So in our current decade, which is 2010 to 2020, that projected percentage of growth is at its peak, 3%, and that's likely from the Affordable Care Act because that has been implemented within this decade. So what's important to note is that the majority of patients seeking access to care now are patients that didn't previously have access to care because they were in a medically underserved area. And this has led to the growth in the number of primary care visits. So this is clearly an ongoing cycle. So more patients are seeking access to care, which is leading to a growth in the number of primary and chronic care visits. But we just talked about how there's a huge physician shortage. So this is just going to keep adding into all of these problems, and we need a solution to help us through this, and pharmacists represent a potential solution. So we have another pit stop. So in the last slide, I told you that medically underserved patients are the ones who have all this increased access to care now because of the Affordable Care Act. So how many counties in West Virginia are considered to be medically underserved?
All of the above.
55.
It's definitely a high number.
45.
So this is a screenshot, and I have the website provided down at the bottom. It actually lets you click on any state, and you can see how many counties in that state are underserved. So you could look for Ohio, for example. So it's kind of hard to read, but 43 out of 55 counties in West Virginia are considered to be underserved. And that's about 80% of all the counties in our whole state. So that's a lot of places where patients now have access to care that didn't previously have access to care. And we are the right profession to help take care of these patients and to take on the burden that some of the physicians are seeing now. Just as a little side note, there are guidelines to determine which areas are medically underserved, and I looked into it because I just wanted to know what goes into that definition. So there's four different things they look at. They look at the ratio of primary care physicians per 1,000 patients, or 1,000 population, the infant mortality rate, the percentage of the population that's over the age of 65, and the percentage of the population that has an income below the poverty level. So a lot of, 80% of our counties in West Virginia fall into those criteria. So I told you that pharmacists are part of the solution, but I didn't necessarily tell you why yet. But Admiral Guyverson's 2011 report does tell us this. So he divides his report into four main focus points, which are pharmacists integrated as healthcare providers, which I'll refer to as just integration, recognition as healthcare providers, which I'll refer to as recognition, compensation mechanisms, and evidence-based alignment with health reform. So I'll be using these four focus points as a skeleton for the remainder of the presentation, and I'll give you some updates that have happened over the last 5 years when I can. So the first focus point is pharmacists integrated as healthcare providers. So once a diagnosis is made, many pharmacists manage disease and deliver patient care services as healthcare providers. This includes a variety of different healthcare settings, whether it be community, inpatient, or outpatient. Dispensing and verifying medications is a vital role in pharmacy. It's the last line of defense before a patient actually takes a medication. And the role of the pharmacist is continuing to evolve, and now in many cases includes the direct management of chronic disease states. And all of the definitions of primary care affirm these integrated patient roles that pharmacists are able to play on the team. So we have another pit stop. So there's three main organizations that provide definitions of primary care. So we have the American Academy of Family Physicians, the Institute of Medicine, and the Care Continuum Alliance. So I'd just like you to take a moment to read through these definitions, and then I'll ask a question afterwards. So would anybody care to comment on how you see pharmacists fitting into these, the services that are mentioned in these definitions? Do you think it's something that we do, we're already doing?
The top, what, four in the American Academy of Family Physicians we do.
Yep. And really, if we're not actively doing one of these things in our practice sites, it's something that we can be doing, and we're fully qualified and well-educated to do. What I wanted you to take away from this was that we do, or can do, all of the things in these definitions, with the exception of diagnosis, which isn't one of them.
I take issue with that. There's one place we do diagnosis, and that's with the drug interactions and the adverse drug reactions,
okay.
And that is our responsibility.
Okay. So based on that, technically we do all of these things. So the main take-home point of this is that by definition, we are primary care providers. So pharmacist integration as healthcare providers is not as new as most people think. The federal sector has supported pharmacist-physician collaboration for over 50 years. The federal sector includes things like the VA, the Department of Defense, the Bureau of Prisons, Indian Health Services as well. Now the non-federal sector is catching up slowly but surely. The uptake and growth has been much slower due to a lot of policy, legislation, and compensation barriers that we've had to face over the years. Now the healthcare delivery system is definitely undergoing a major transformation, and a lot of the health plans and even providers and provider groups are exploring ways to deliver more cost-effective care. And this includes the integration of pharmacy services within their team models. So some of these new integrated care delivery models, which are listed on the left-hand side, include things like accountable care organizations, which Jennifer talked about, primary care medical homes, medical neighborhoods, and integrated delivery networks. And some of the services that we can provide in these models include collaborative practice agreements, which we've already talked about quite a bit. So our presentations line up well. Medication therapy management, comprehensive medication management, chronic care management, as well as transitions of care. So the pharmacist's presence in these care delivery models is slowly but surely starting to become a standard of care now. So pharmacists are continuing to gain support from other members of the healthcare team, whether it be physicians, nurses, social workers. There was a United States Public Health Service survey in 2008 that reported a 96% physician satisfaction rate. Now, this is just one of many services that have been conducted on this, but I want you to keep in mind that this service did come from the federal sector, where we've been collaborating with physicians for over 50 years. a focus of more recent primary literature for ambulatory care and other healthcare settings has definitely been provider and patient satisfaction with pharmacy services. So this is something that we're starting to grow a bigger data bank for in the non-federal sector, and the results are definitely very encouraging. In 2013, it was estimated that 5 to 15% of physicians actively push back, but another 30% are supportive. So this is commonly referred to as the turf battle. Has anybody heard of the turf battle before? So it's starting, luckily, to become more of a myth than it is an actual barrier, and that's due to a lot of different factors that we'll talk about. But a lot of physicians might think that we're trying to take over their territory, that we're trying to steal their patients, or I've heard, you're trying to take all the easy patients from me and give me all the hard ones, or even walking the line of diagnosis in certain situations. But the bottom line, from my perspective, and even some physician perspectives, is that we already know physicians are overworked. And we just talked about the huge provider workforce shortage. So they do need help, and we can all do this together. By working together with physicians, we can increase the number of patients that we're able to help take care of. And we saw how the numbers are increasing with primary care visits and chronic care visits, and how many people now have access to care that didn't have it before. But we don't have enough people to see all of those patients, so we need to work with physicians and nurse practitioners and PAs to help give access and reach more patients. By doing this, we can actually shift the time for physicians and allow them to focus on the patients that need their care the most. So this might be more acute care issues, more intense patient cases. But all the healthcare providers need to work together for this to be successful. And when it is successful, everybody wins, but most importantly, the patients win. The good thing is that most of the health profession schools now are actively teaching collaborative practice and interprofessional education. So we know that it's in our standards now, the updated standards for pharmacy education, but it's also something that's included in medical education for PA students, for example. We work very closely with them on our campus here at UC, also nurses and nurse practitioners as well. So it's also worth noting that to date, no physician groups have expressed opposition to the bill. And I'm willing to bet that 5 to 15% pushback includes some individual physicians that maybe just haven't had the opportunity to work with pharmacists yet. So this is something that we can all have an impact with and our students as well. So now let's move on to the second focus point, which is recognition as healthcare providers. So even though we're already integrated as healthcare providers, as we saw with a lot of those service delivery models, we're still not recognized as healthcare providers within the Social Security Act and other health legislation and policy. So it feels like the Social Security Act recognizes everybody except pharmacists. So it includes people like physicians, nurse practitioners, physician assistants, midwives, psychologists, social workers, speech language pathologists, audiologists, registered dietitians, physical therapists, and dentists. So I'm not trying to say that any one of these individuals is not a healthcare provider, but why aren't we on that list? And that's a federal document where a lot of payers are getting their information on who we're able to compensate, and we're not in this definition. So the education and training we receive as pharmacists fully prepares us to enter the field as healthcare providers, regardless of what setting we're going to practice in. And it's a very comparable pattern to that of physicians. So we know there's been a definite shift towards clinical services and interprofessional collaboration over the years. The number of years to obtain a pharmacy degree has definitely increased over the years. We started as a bachelor's degree, we moved to a doctorate degree. There's mandatory physician shadowing and hospital experiences. We have our APPE rotations. We have a standardized examination upon graduation, the NAPLEX and the MPJE. We have a lot of postgraduate training opportunities now, whether they be residencies or fellowships. We also have a variety of clinical specialty certifications, or all the letters that we can put after our names now. So those are all of the things that go to show our education and training fully prepare us to be healthcare providers. So this map shows all of the states, which are in blue, that have proposed provider status status legislation as of March 22nd, 2015. So it's about a year old now. Now, all of these states, many of these states currently recognize pharmacists as healthcare providers, whether it's directly in their state law or in the Medicare provider manual. And West Virginia is included in one of these blue states. And I don't know if you remember from Dave's presentation, but he had a slide with the definition of a healthcare provider from the West Virginia legislature. So that's different from the Social Security Act because we were included in that definition. So we're in a good place for West Virginia. That big long list of people that qualify as healthcare providers included us, but we need to get that on a federal level now. There's little correlation between state recognition as providers and actual payment for services. So being recognized by your state as a healthcare provider is definitely a step in the right direction. But in order to standardize the compensation and make sure that pharmacists in all states can be compensated for their services, we need to get federal recognition.
So who do we talk to? Or annoy, better yet.
Well, we've got a couple of bills in the legislation that will help address this, but I will talk about this. So for also on the long lines with recognition as healthcare providers, so I mentioned previously that pharmacists are integrated in several of the new healthcare delivery models, and one of the services that you can provide for these models is collaborative practice, which Jennifer focused on a lot in the last presentation. So I won't go into detail about what that is, but these maps start in 1997 and go all the way to 2015, so you can see that the number of states that allow collaborative drug therapy, which are the states in the darker color, is dramatically increasing and has increased over the years. So to my knowledge, and I think this was slightly different than what Jennifer had in her presentation, I think Alabama is the only state left now that doesn't have any sort of collaborative practice legislation. And I think that was a recent change because Oklahoma was the other state. And I think something happened there recently. So I don't know if you had different information or...
Yeah, mine was probably right before the change happened. Yeah.
These are very, very recent. But as far as I know, Alabama's the one that we got to get them back on the bandwagon. But this is very, very encouraging that all of these states support pharmacists collaborating with other healthcare providers. So the third focus point involves compensation mechanisms. So the lack of compensation mechanisms is a current barrier for optimal health system outcomes and ultimately the expansion and sustainability of pharmacist involvement. So in other words, we cannot continue to expand our role as healthcare providers if we don't achieve proper compensation for what we're doing. So I did want to talk about some of the current billing mechanisms that we are being reimbursed through. So in the community setting, pharmacists provide and are fairly well reimbursed for medication therapy management, or MTM. In the hospital setting or ambulatory care setting, pharmacists can work under the direct supervision of and in collaboration with physicians, PAs, or nurse practitioners. And several of these services can be billed as incident two, which Jennifer also talked about, so I won't go into too much detail. But it does involve CPT codes, chronic care management, transitional care management, Medicare annual wellness visits, and outpatient facility billing. And there are a lot of other services that certain pharmacists are able to bill for. And these include things like immunizations, medication reconciliation, patient education and counseling, screening and point of care testing, and also collaborative drug therapy management. Now, the pharmacists that can bill for these things in that other section are likely pharmacists that have negotiated their own contracts with individual payers, which is completely fine and completely allowed to do as long as it falls within your state scope of practice. So that is excellent news that physicians are being compensated for providing all of these services that are listed in the other box. But what we need to do is standardize these payment models so that any pharmacist providing any one of these services is able to get compensated. Because right now, only certain people that have negotiated certain contracts are able to get paid for it. And one way to standardize this process is to gain federal recognition as a healthcare provider. So So overall, as you saw on the last slide, the billing process for pharmacists is unstandardized across systems and settings of care, which is a very big barrier for us. So I do think it's important for us to know the timeline for payment models for our healthcare system, where we've been and where we're going. So the earlier payment models are on the left, and the more recent ones and the future ones are on the right. So we'll start on the left with traditional fee-for-service. So it's exactly what it sounds like. You do something for a patient, and you get paid for it. So it's based purely on patient volume. The more patients you see, the more money and the more profit you can make. But when you think about it, you're essentially getting paid when patients are unhealthy. So a patient is sick and they need a lab test. You get paid because the patient's sick. When they're healthy, they don't come in to see you and you don't get paid. And there's really no link to quality with this. Luckily, we've moved somewhat away from this. The next stop on that timeline of the healthcare payment models is fee-for-service, but with a link to quality this time. So this is better, but still kind of, we could do better. So an example of this is a hospital program that aims to reduce readmission rates. And I don't want to downplay this at all because it's an excellent thing. We don't want our patients coming back to the hospital. This is when you're looking at them and really preventing them from coming back. But what if you took it one step further and prevented that very first hospital encounter? So they never even went to the hospital for the first place. And that's really where we wanted to move forward from with that fee-for-service link to quality, which is better, but we can do better as a population in taking care of our patients. So the alternative payment models is where we are now. It's still based on a fee-for-service foundation, so that part's not eliminated quite yet. So some payment is still triggered by that initial episode of care. And this is where we are now. So it's linked to more effective population management. And this includes things like the accountable care organizations, the primary care medical homes. This is where we're shifting to now. And essentially in these organizations, all of the risks and savings are shared by all the providers in this network and everybody that's involved in the patient's care. So population-based care is where we hope to be someday. So the focus is preventative care and minimizing the need for expensive interventions in the first place, like a hospitalization or a surgery or a test. So remember that with fee-for-service, we profit when the patient is unhealthy and they need a test. But both the alternative payment models and population-based care pay us to keep our patients healthy. So the difference between the alternative payment model and population-based care is that population-based care completely eliminates that fee-for-service component. So that's the main difference between those two. And we're not quite there yet, but that's where we hope to be in the coming years. So the fourth and final focus point of the report is evidence-based alignment with health reform. And this is really just the icing on the cake. It compiles all of the evidence to show that through the delivery of patient care services, pharmacists improve outcomes, we increase access for the medically underserved, we improve patient safety, we shift time for physicians to focus on diagnosis and more critically ill patients, we improve patient and provider satisfaction, we enhance cost effectiveness, and we improve the overall quality of healthcare by impacting those demands of cost, quality, and access. So this was taken directly from the 2011 Surgeon General Report. It's an analysis of the economic value of clinical pharmacy services over a period of 2 decades. And it shows the return on investment for every $1 that's allocated to clinical pharmacy services. So what I really wanted to point out was that even at our lowest level, we still are having benefit. And these numbers have only increased. The overall average of this particular chart is that for every dollar that's been invested in clinical pharmacy services, $10.07 was generated as return on investment. So that's the overall average. The ones that are highlighted are just showing that we still have benefit even at the lowest level. So similar to things like interprofessional support and provider satisfaction, a focus of more recent primary literature has been on showing the return on investment or profitability of pharmacists that provide these expanded patient care roles. And I can tell you that the results are very encouraging. If we want to justify being paid more for our services, we definitely need to have more data to show that we can save more money than it takes to pay us. So we are moving in that direction for sure. So we made it through all the four focus points, so whatever happened to the report? Well, the primary objective was to gain advocacy and support from the Surgeon General of the United States. So we did indeed receive support from Regina Benjamin, who was the Surgeon General at that time. And this is a screenshot of the letter that she wrote in response. And it says that this report provides the evidence health leaders and policymakers need to support evidence-based models of cost-effective patient care that utilizes the expertise and contributions of our nation's pharmacists as an essential part of the healthcare team. So we know that the Surgeon General is a very influential person in our nation, and it's definitely a good person to have on our side. And Regina Benjamin is no longer the Surgeon General, but she is actively involved in the United States Public Health Service and still serves a very important role. All right, so for the remainder of the presentation, I'm just going to focus on some of the provider status updates and our current efforts to achieve provider status. So I did want to talk a little bit about the progress that was made in 2015. So Pharmacists Provide Care is APHA's campaign for pharmacists recognition as healthcare providers. And in a recent update that they sent out, they mentioned that this was the largest grassroots advocacy effort in their 163-year history, which is pretty major. There's over 21,000 supporters. We have sent over 40,000 letters to Congress, and there's a lot of video testimonials out there from physicians, nurses, PAs, nurse practitioners, pharmacists, and even patients that support us expanding our patient care services. On the state level, for provider status initiatives, there were 95 bills introduced in 2015, and that's three times as many as were introduced in 2014, so definitely a big improvement. 16 of these bills looked at designating pharmacists as providers in their state legislature, 24 looked at payment for services, and 55 on addressing scope of practice issues. So that was on a state level, but let's talk about what we're doing to gain provider status on the federal level or the national level, because that's really what we need to do to standardize the process. So the PAPCC, which is Patient Access to Pharmacist Care Coalition, includes organizations like APHA and ASHP and AACP, and they support two different bills, one in the House of Representatives, which is HR 592, and one in the Senate. And they're essentially the same bill, just in different areas right now, but S-314. So this bill is entitled Pharmacy and Medically Underserved Areas Enhancement Act. And it's, you can tell in the title, but it's specific to locations that are defined as medically underserved. So we already talked about how 80% of West Virginia counties are considered to be underserved. So they took this approach versus trying to get provider status for everywhere to kind of limit the opposition and bring down the cost of legislation. I was reading recently and I thought it was interesting that nurse practitioners and PAs actually took the same pathway. So when they were trying to gain the ability to expand their services and be recognized as healthcare providers, they started off by specifying they would do this in medically underserved areas, but that was lifted, I think, for nurse practitioners in 1990, and they were able to provide their services everywhere. So we're kind of following a similar path that they did as well, and I found that very interesting. But we're also, by taking this, you know, and specifying it to medically underserved area, we're really targeting the patients that probably need our services the most, so I think that's a smart path to take. The primary objectives of these bills are to obtain Medicare Part B coverage of pharmacist services, so that would be through recognition as a healthcare provider in the Social Security Act. We would define payment for pharmacist services. It's proposed to be equal to 80% of the lesser of the actual charge, or 85% of what a physician would charge. And then we would also have pharmacist-specific codes under the physician fee schedule that would be designated by the Department of Health and Human Services. All right, so we have another pit stop. So in order to become a law, the bill has to be passed in both the House of Representatives and the Senate, and then eventually by the president. And the piece of legislation is introduced. and then it's eventually referred to a committee, and then it's placed on a calendar, and it's debated, and it's eventually voted on. So that's kind of the cheat sheet to how a bill becomes a law type thing. But co-sponsorship is something that legislative members can do to add their name in support of the bill, and they have up until the vote to do so. So they can co-sponsor something all the way up until it's voted on. And it's good because it can help to predict the turnout of the vote, because typically if you co-sponsor a bill, then you're probably going to vote in support of it. So this is updated as of 2 days ago. This stuff changes quickly, so hopefully the numbers haven't changed too much. But we have 284 co-sponsors for the bill that's in the House of Representatives. Does anybody know how many we would need to get the majority for the House of Representatives? I had to look this up, don't worry. Anybody want to take a guess how many House of Representatives we have? Or officials from that we have? Yeah, 435 is the total number. So half of that we would need to get the majority. And we have exceeded the majority for the House of Representatives. We have 65%. So we're doing really well. So if the House of Representatives were to vote on this right now, it would likely pass. So how many would we need to get the majority for the Senate? Or how many total Senate members do we have? 100? Yes. That one's a little bit easier. So to get the majority, we would need technically 51, and we have 44 co-sponsors.
60. You might.
Just to be sure. So that's good. We're close, but not quite there for the Senate. Now, this isn't the actual vote. This is just those that have co-sponsored the bill. So people can change when they vote, but this gives us a good idea of how that vote might go when it does come to that time. So I did look as an update for the last actions on either of these bills, and the House of Representatives bill is currently in the Committee on Health, and the Senate bill was recently referred to the Committee on Finance. So they are moving around in there. So I think it's important for you to know who your elected officials are, both in the House of Representatives and the Senate. So we have three members from the House of Representatives for West Virginia. Does anybody know who they are? Mike?
Moody, Jenkins.
Oh, are you looking on the slides?
No, I mean, I just know about the picture.
Oh, that's good. Oh, that's true. I guess I don't have the names on there. So this is Alex Moody. He is District 2. Then we have Evan Jenkins, who's District 3. And we have David McKinley, who is District 1 for West Virginia. Does anybody know if they have co-sponsored this bill or not? Or anybody want to take a guess without cheating? Not that you were cheating, but.
I would hope they have.
So we would hope that they have. So the good news is that the first two have. So Alex Mooney and Evan Jenkins have signed on, and they are co-sponsors of the House of Representatives bill. But we still have one that we can work on, and that's David McKinley.
Has he said no, or has he just said hasn't?
He has not said no. It's just not. He's been ambivalent. No sign of support.
Okay, so you get a hold of his wife and resolve that issue.
That would probably work. Okay, so now moving on to the Senate, we have two senators for our state. Does anybody know who they are? Yep. Got it. Shelley Capito and Joe Manchin. So Shelley signed on very early to co-sponsor this bill. I was very pleased to find out as of April 28th, so very, very recently, Joe Manchin did sign on to co-sponsor the bill as well. So that is excellent news. And that the Senate is the one that, you know, we don't have the majority yet, so that was big. If you're not familiar with the officials, I have the link on the bottom and also on your slides where you can look it up very easily. If you're in a different state, for example, it's sponsored by APHA, but it allows you to search by your zip code so you can see the different districts and Senate and House of Representatives. Okay, so I did want to draw your attention to an initiative with a similar end goal, but they take a little bit of a different approach to expanding pharmacy services. So ACCP and CPNP, which is the College of Psychiatric and Neurologic Pharmacists, chose not to focus so much on recognizing pharmacists as providers, but instead placing more emphasis on the actual service that's provided. So they've designated this service as CMM, or Comprehensive Medication Management. And it's a standard of care that ensures each patient's medications are individually assessed for safety and efficacy. So instead of amending the Social Security Act to recognize pharmacists as healthcare providers, they would like to amend Medicare Part B to cover CMM that's provided by qualified clinical services. Now CMM, it is important to note that it's currently not included in Medicare Part B, but it is a standard of practice already under many private and government healthcare delivery models and insurance programs. So it is something that we're already doing, we're just not recognized under Medicare Part B to get coverage for that. I do have qualified clinical pharmacists in quotations because they do specify that qualified clinical pharmacists must be board certified or board eligible. So that's an additional requirement for some of those pharmacists to go through if this were to pass. So they do have the same end goal, they're just taking a little bit of a different route, and I think it's important to be aware of all of the different initiatives.
Are they talking about BCPS or just our regular NAPLEX?
They're talking about BCPS, okay. Or BCACP, or okay. Some sort of additional certification beyond the degree. Okay, so we're definitely nearing the end here. And I've talked a lot about the positive aspects of provider status, but there are a lot of barriers that we need to overcome first. And an important part of advocacy is expecting that opposition and being able to understand both sides of the story. So this list is not all-inclusive by any means, but it's just some of the most common arguments that I've heard and other people have heard for provider status, or arguments against provider status. So I'm going to start at the top left. So it's no secret that there's a lot of issues, a lot of other issues going on in our country right now, and a lot of people feel that Congress should devote their resources and money for the nation's spending to other things right now. I do agree with this to some extent, but I also feel like healthcare should be a priority, and the sooner we get started on addressing the healthcare dilemma, the more money that we can save in the long run. So that's kind of a hard one to argue because you can't argue that there's a lot of other things going on in our country right now. So you might have noticed in the details about the two bills in the House of Representatives and the Senate that it seems to promote a fee-for-service model. So I mentioned that payment for pharmacy services would be defined as 80 to 85% of what a physician would charge. So it's important to point out that healthcare is moving in the direction of population-based care where we would completely eliminate that fee-for-service component. But we're not there yet, so we need a way to sustain ourselves until we get to that point. But I do want to point out the main part of that bill is not necessarily the fee schedule that we would charge. It's more about the recognition as healthcare providers in the Social Security Act. And that is always going to be a basis for determining eligibility for compensation, regardless of if it's fee for service or if they're paying us for keeping patients healthy. So we also have the scoring of the bill by the Congressional Budget Office. So after they're drafted, they're assigned a score from this office to assess their financial impact. And just because we're saving money by improving patient care doesn't mean that it's enough to outweigh our compensation. So we have to work as pharmacists in the field on providing more information and more research that define our return on investment to help support this. So as you could imagine, there are increased health plan costs for third-party payers and patients up front, but what we need to do is convince third-party payers and patients that it's worth the investment and that the cost savings in the long run far outweigh the upfront costs. You know, it might be an additional copay for a patient, or a plan might have to put more money up front, but we need to show them that the benefits of doing that far outweigh the upfront cost to them. So that's going to take some time to convince them to buy into it. We do have division among the profession of pharmacy, so not every pharmacist is involved in direct patient care, nor do they want to be involved in direct patient care. However, this legislation doesn't affect everyone, but it does open up the door for those who do want to be involved in direct patient care services. Some of the states that grant pharmacist provider status have mandated additional education where whether it be board eligible or board certification, continuing education, different certifications, but that's only on a state level. That would not be mandated federally, so you wouldn't have to do that to be a pharmacist. And it's going to depend on the state that you're in. And that would only be necessary if you chose to engage in these expanded patient care services. So it's not something that a pharmacist would have to do if we were to gain provider status. And I think that's a really common question that comes up. So we already talked about turf battles, so I won't go too much into that. So if I had to pick one on this list, that's my favorite barrier to talk about, not that any barriers are good barriers. It's the growth mindset versus fixed mindset one. So after a few years of advocating very hard for pharmacist recognition as healthcare providers, I asked myself the question, do we really need provider status to accomplish our goals? And my answer was no. I don't think that we need this. Look how much pharmacy has grown without provider status. And in some cases, I actually think not having provider status has been a good thing, because it has forced us to be innovative and come up with new ideas on how to get compensated on the state level. So will provider status make this process a lot easier? Yes, and it'll make the change happen much more quickly. But do we need it to grow as a profession? No, I don't think that we need it. And I think it's all about having a growth mindset and not fixating on this one thing, so that if for some reason we don't get provider status, oh, I guess we can't be pharmacists anymore. That's not the case at all. We still have a lot of room to grow. It just might be a slower process without it. Conflicts of interest is an interesting one. I think it's something that we're going to need to address in legislation moving forward. But just like we wouldn't want physicians to dispense the medications that they prescribe, you wouldn't want a pharmacist to dispense a medication that they recommended. So there's a conflict of interest there. And that these two pharmacist roles will need to stay separated or somehow have that specified in the legislation. But if we address that up front, it won't be a reason to oppose the bill moving forward. And last but not least, pharmacist provider status versus medical provider status. I did watch a very interesting webinar recently on this, but it talks about the difference between pharmacist provider status and medical provider status, and really not limiting ourselves to pharmacist-specific codes or pharmacist-specific roles. So it would be a much broader term. I think it would be useful down the road, but I don't think we want to get too far ahead of ourselves right now. But I wanted to mention it because I thought it was an interesting concept. So this is the last pit stop, and you may or may not have an answer to it, but has anybody ever encountered any different barriers to provider status, or heard opposition, or have opposition yourself? I mean, this isn't right for everybody.
What is our liability? I mean, right now we all enjoy really low insurance.
Yes.
And so once we become provider status, what does that do to our liability insurance?
That's a huge discussion. I think even within the state of West Virginia, we open ourselves up to more malpractice claims, just like physicians. So do we need to have insurance to cover that? And if you choose to engage in this type of service, depending on your state, I think those requirements might be higher. So I know for West Virginia, to participate in a collaborative practice agreement, you have to have $1 million in liability insurance. So for a pharmacist that doesn't want to provide that service and doesn't want to be in a collaborative practice agreement, they don't have to worry about it. So it's really only if you choose to engage. But if you choose to engage in that expanded service, then you choose to take on that liability. So that's definitely scary.
I guess the question is, though, is if it becomes an automatic rule or law, then we've already been put into that provider status in that situation, whether we wanted to or not.
I think it would fall under the jurisdiction of your state.
Okay.
So a big thing is that this change would, yes, it would make us a healthcare provider in the Social Security Act, but the choice on the specifications for who does it, whether it's certifications, additional continuing education, additional fees, liability insurance, that will always fall under the state jurisdiction.
So you're thinking akin to like what we do with our consultant pharmacists?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Anybody else have any thoughts? Okay. So because it is the Preceptor Development Symposium, I wanted to close with some of the activities that students could potentially get involved with to promote this initiative. And many of these are activities that I participated in as a student and also as a resident, and activities that I've also conducted here at UC with some of the students in the ambulatory care elective. But a lot of it involves familiarizing yourself and utilizing some of the resources that are available. So I know it's not the most exciting activity, but I did it as a student, and I think it really changed the way that I thought about pharmacy and the framework of pharmacy that I read, and I had to summarize the 2011 Surgeon General Report. I think developing a legislative cheat sheet is useful for students, so this doesn't have to apply just for pharmacists as providers. This could be really for any advocacy issue that might impact your setting of care, but they can find different pieces, they can practice searching for different pieces of legislation that might impact your setting and summarize it maybe in three main bullet points. And it's a cheat sheet for them because as pharmacists, if there's any piece of legislation or issue that impacts you or your practice, people might come to you and ask questions about it, and you want to be prepared and at least know where you stand beforehand. So that's useful for students to do. In the ambulatory care elective, which is coordinated by Cassie and Jennifer, who are here today, we had a debate, so half the class was for provider status and half the class was against it, and I thought it was really fun and we got some good student feedback from that. Also, you can tell your story as, develop and practice an elevator speech. This is one of my favorite ones to do with students. So it's the idea that you never know who you're gonna be standing in an elevator next to or how long you might have, whether it's 30 seconds or maybe it's a really long elevator ride and it's a couple minutes. But say you were in the elevator with the Surgeon General, what would you say to them to advocate for the issue that you're passionate about? And it doesn't necessarily have to be provider status. But I think it's important to have that in your back pocket so that if you need to advocate for it and you only have a minute, you know that what you would, you know exactly what you would say to do that. So I think it's fun to have students develop an elevator speech about something they're passionate about, even if it's not pharmacy related, but then practice giving that to people that have no background knowledge of what they're talking about, and it's a good activity. Tell your story as a patient care provider. So you can write letters or send postcards to your representatives. Something that I did as a PGY2 resident is I was in Florida at the time, but I scheduled a visit for one of our senators to come spend the day with me at my family medicine clinic and see what I do and why I'm so passionate about provider status. I found that to be really effective. And that's something that wouldn't necessarily take away from your time. You can have your students be there the whole day and really show them around your practice site. You can also have students contribute through blogs and commentaries, but ultimately stay involved in professional pharmacy organizations or any political action committees. A lot of the organizations have things like health fairs. We have our Script Your Future campaign here. There's legislative days. And a lot of other organizational initiatives that we're looking for students and preceptors to be involved with. So just a few final thoughts. So be prepared for the good and the bad. On a state level, West Virginia is in a very good position. So if provider status legislation were passed tomorrow, we would be in a good position and we would be able to fully embrace this. There are some states that have a very limited scope of practice that wouldn't be ready if this were to happen tomorrow. But don't fully rely on the change. I know I already talked about that growth mindset, but don't let this hold you back. Keep trying to grow and be innovative and come up with new compensation models. Always expect opposition and know what you would say to it. Partnerships at the federal, state, and local levels are key. Advocate for the progression of clinical pharmacy. And last but not least, remember why you're doing this in the first place. It's for the patients, it's for the people that we take care of, and it's about improving their care. So I will leave you with a quote from the 2011 Surgeon General Report. So it's time to enact legislation to recognize and compensate pharmacists, reflecting a change in pharmacy practice that has already occurred. And that's all I have. Does anybody have any questions?